Hey, well, good morning, good morning. Isn't it great to hear people? We're so excited. Man, we do miss being together, and I hope this doesn't go on much longer. We're praying we can gather very soon, so we'll see. I think we're at week number 10. I believe this is Sunday number 10, so thank you for joining us. Thanks for participating online, and did you enjoy worship this morning? Isn't it awesome? So, hey, well, we are living in strange and crazy times, aren't we? Today's message is called Strange Days. So we are living in strange days. So I want to show you something before I get started here. We're going to have a short message, and then we're going to take some time and pray. We're going to have different groups of our staff praying. We've been praying like crazy for you and for our city, for our state, and for the nations of the earth. So before I get started, I found this crazy article. I don't know if you guys saw this, but these things called sanitizing tunnels, and you'll see some pictures come up. But these are sanitizing tunnels. I've never heard about them. They don't have any in the U.S. yet, but these are like human car washes, and that people walk through them, and they're in Mexico and Chile and in Kenya. I think they're in Italy. There's some lots of places, but it's an inflatable tunnel that people walk through. What I was concerned is what they spray them with, but they spray them with a thing called biozinc, which isn't supposed to kill anybody. It's actually supposed to strengthen their immune system. So there's one going right into Nogales, Mexico, right there out of from Arizona to the border of Mexico, but I thought, what an unusual thing. And as I looked at these, I thought, man, I wish I had one of these with my kids were all little. Just put one in my backyard, just run them right through the sanitizer, bring them in, right? Anybody else with these? Sorry, that would have been perfect. I don't know if I'd use biozinc, but whatever we'd use. But we are living in unusual times, all right? And really, we're forced to live in so kind of craziness, and we're wearing masks, which is so difficult. We're working from home. Schools are operating from home. And so much of what is normal has been put on pause. And in times of like this, like national emergencies or times of crisis, times like the what they call pandemics, actually which one we're living in, that epidemiologists are those people that study disease. And actually, I have a degree in healthcare management, and we took a lot of classes in epidemiology. And they've discovered some common patterns of human behavior. So I'm going to mention a few of these. And actually, the number one response in all of the ones in history and the one today is fear. And the number one response in this pandemic is the fear of a family getting sick. Okay, check that out. Fear. Fear of family getting sick. The next one is fear of not having enough. Fear of not knowing about the future. The fear of death. And I just want to declare to you, this is not of God. You know that? 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. I'm just going to remind you of some of our foundational cliche beliefs. But this scripture says, God did not give you a spirit of fear. Do you hear me? God did not give you, America, a spirit of fear. What did he do? He gave you a spirit of love, a spirit of power, of love, and a sound mind. Isn't that awesome? Our God has given you a spirit of power. That's the Holy Spirit of power that dwells within you. A spirit of love, that love of God. That's who God is, and he's in you. And a spirit of a sound mind. We can have the mind of Christ in these types of situations. Are you with me, church? Somebody say amen out there, okay? Give me it. I can hear you through the internet, all right? But fear is a horrible thing because fear keeps people from being who God has called them to be. You know that? Fear keeps people from doing what God has called them to do. Proverbs chapter 29, verse 25 says, "Fear, the fear of man is ensnares. A snare is a trap. It keeps us locked down so we can't move forward or do the things God's called us to do or be the people God's called us to be." All right? So the fear is not of God. You hear me? Everybody hear me loud and clear. Don't let the spirit of fear overtake you. Come on. I'm telling you, everything we hear in the across the media, I'd say 99% of what we hear is negative. Anybody listening to the news lately? I try not to anymore, but every morning we are conditioned to say, how many died? How many got sick? How many died? How many got sick? And as we listen to it over and over, we come under that spirit, almost like, oh, this is the way it is. But it's not, okay? There's so much more good news out there, I have to tell you. There's so much more good news than bad news. And why are we not hearing it? Because bad news sells. It's horrible, isn't it? Come on, I've talked to people and they say, well, you can't deny domestic violence and child abuse has been increased. Yes, I do understand that. Domestic violence and child abuse has increased. Addictive behavior has increased. Child psychologists and divorce lawyers and marriage counselors all predicted this huge doom and gloom during this time. But you know what? There's all kinds of reports are coming to the forefront right now that contradict this narrative. Okay, so I want to shout it as loud as I could. All right. The New York Post just reported this past week, last Wednesday, they said children are actually happier. Families are getting along better. Isn't that good? You don't hear this. There's a newfound appreciation for our family life. Isn't that awesome? Sales figures have shown that board games are selling like hotcakes. All right? It's hard to find a Monopoly game online. Isn't that cool? All right? The craze, that there's this huge craze for home baking. That there's been a shortage, so much so there's a shortage of flour. Why families are baking bread together, they're making meals together. Isn't it good? I found this the other day. There's a Facebook group called Unintended Positives from Shelter in Place 2020. I know that's a big name. I'll say it again. It's a Facebook group called Unintended Positives from Shelter in Place 2020. And it's got thousands, I think it's almost 10,000 members, and they're sharing the silver linings of this pandemic. Isn't that cool? So I'm just going to read you. Is it okay if I read a few of those? Well, I am anyhow, whether you like it or not. Get a cup of coffee and sit down, all right? There's a mother in Texas whose daughter had come home to live. Yeah, thanks. Has come home to live, and she's an adult, and came home to live, and she wrote to the local newspaper and said, "We make bread together, we make dinner together, we make desserts together, and all of us laugh together like little kids. I almost never want it to end." Isn't that awesome? Come on. There's another mom reported about the joy of being with her sons. She said, "I caught my oldest son helping his little brother with his online Spanish class and heard the conversations filled with advice, and it just melts my heart." Isn't that good? So good. I just want to take a moment and get something to drink here. And it's great. Another couple reported. It's an older couple. They reported that the husband said, "We're practicing our foxtrot together. We love our daily dancing date. We're getting good at it, and it brings us closer together." Isn't that awesome? Come on, guys. We need to hear this stuff. CNN reported this. Under the headline, you can look it up: "Why Some Kids Are Happier Right Now and Other Unexpected Effects of Quarantine." This is CNN. They said thousands of parents from around the United States feel a sense of relief and joy that their children are happier. Isn't that cool? Come on, one mother said her kids, now to check out the ages of her kids, 8, 7, and 4, they become better behaved, they're kinder to one another, and they're more independent. It's been really eye-opening. I don't want it to go back to the way things were. Is that cool? I was like, God, this is such, we need to hear these reports, don't we? Come on, I want to remind you today that God, our God, is a healer. Psalm 103, we know this, right? Don't forget all of his benefits, right? Everybody gets a job today. They want to know what the bennies are. Well, here's some good bennies in Psalm 103, okay? Benefits, he heals all our diseases, all right? It's right there, clear as day. He heals all of our diseases. He's not the one to bring sickness and disease upon you, all right? Come on, I just want to, man, I've been reading so many stories about elderly people being healed, surviving this COVID-19. All right, thousands and thousands of seniors have recovered. I'd say hundreds of thousands, millions that we haven't heard about. You know that? How about 90-year-old Geneva Wood of Seattle? She recovered from COVID-19 at the same time recovering from a recent stroke. That's amazing, isn't it? Come on, a 94-year-old lady named Joy. She's a great grandmother, recovering wonderfully. A 95-year-old Alma Corsini. They think she's the oldest Italian woman to be doing great as she's recovering from COVID-19. Isn't this great? William Kelly, a 95-year-old World War II vet who's lived through the Great Depression, is recovering wonderfully. Another World War II vet, Bill Lapshees. He celebrated his 104th birthday 2 days after he got released from the hospital after he recovered from COVID-19. 104, folks. Come on, get a vision, all right? Are you with me? Isn't this great? I thought, yes, thousands and thousands of great recovery stories that we're never hearing about. We're hearing about the 1% or the 2% of an entire population of a residential care facility. We're not hearing of the 97 or 98% of those that have recovered, those whose immune systems were strong and healthy, as 80-year-olds and 90-year-olds and 95-year-olds and 104-year-olds. Isn't that awesome? I thought, wow, come on. I just want to encourage you today and say, God is your provider. Don't be afraid. Come on, don't be afraid you won't have enough. He's always the God of more than enough. We need to declare that today. All right, with millions in unemployment. Unemployment skyrocketed. It's never been this high in the history of America. It's a place like, wait a minute, we don't care. God is our provider. He will make a way. Do you hear me, church? We need to shout this across the nations, all right? He is our source. Jeremiah 29:11 says, he has great plans for you. What? To give you a hope and to give you a future. I love that, all right? He's not done, folks. Till the whole earth is full of his glory, right? I love it. All the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. We need to declare it over and over, all right? Come on. Secondly, another response in this kind of pandemic is judgment. Many of us are judging everyone and everything. I'm right in there, folks, okay? It's challenging not to judge some of the decisions our government is making, all right? Or to judge others who are not agreeing with the decision, or judge others that aren't keeping the rules. You know, I love keeping the rules. Help me, Holy Spirit, all right? But it's like, why is one business deemed an essential business and the other one is not? Is it unfair? Absolutely. It's horrible, okay? But don't let your heart get bitter. Don't let it get stuck in judgment. Do you understand? Come on. I walked into a building supply store the other day and had my mask, you know, my face mask about down to here. Man, I went into a return section, 20 eyes spun around and looked at me, some with judgment, some with anger, some with fear. Get away, you know, and I was like, hey, good morning, everyone. Put my mask on. I thought, oh my God, I haven't felt this kind of peer pressure since high school. Like, shut up. It was intense. But I was one of those pandemic jerks that everybody talks about. You could feel them, pandemic jerk. I'm like, okay, I'll just get happy, stay happy, right? But Jesus tells us in the Gospels in Luke chapter 6, he says, don't judge and you won't be judged, all right? He says in John chapter 7, don't judge according to appearance. Things are not always what they appear to be. Are you there? Come on, all right? A third major response, I'm just going to cut it off here, is anger, which is, you know, grown out of a massive frustration. And it's so hard in this lockdown just to be stuck in what I call camp anger. And if you run into people like this in stores, man, they're just angry all the time. I walked by a guy the other day, and he was just cursing under his mask, like, rah, 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 rah. I thought, wow. It just was a spirit of anger on him. I said, oh, God, just give him peace, you know? But it's really hard not to get in that place and stay in that place because of the unfairness that we feel, right? If you're with me, it's unfairness of what we've experienced, especially business owners. It's horrible. But I want to encourage you today. I want to remind you today that anger never helps. James chapter 1, verse 20 says, the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God, all right? You may not agree with the decisions that are being made. You know, I may not agree with, most of us don't agree with how life's been going for the past few months, but we got to allow our God of hope, our God of peace, our God of love to have his way in our hearts. Do you agree with me, church? Come on. I want to remind you today that God is love, right? And that he loves you, and he loved you before you ever knew about it. He loves you now more than ever, and he's going to love you forever, right? Jeremiah 31:3 says, he loves you with an everlasting love. Isn't that good? That means he's always going to be loving you. He's never going to stop loving you. Come on, I want to remind you today that he's always with you. He's always with you. His Holy Spirit is not only upon you, but he's in you. And he said in Hebrews chapter 13, I'll never leave you. I will never forsake you. Doesn't matter what your feelings are when you wake up in the morning, he's with you. Do you hear me? Come on. Jeremiah 29, I'm going to read it again. His great plans for you. Come on. Of a hope and a future. His plans to prosper you. I love that part. Plans to prosper you, says the Lord. All right? We were just singing it. He is for you. He is for you. He is for you. He's not against you. I love this blessing song we've been singing with Carrie Job. And it's just wonderful, isn't it? Singing the blessing of the Lord upon people's lives and saying, he is for you. He's not against you. If he's for you, who can be against you? All right? We need to remind ourselves of this, all right? I'll leave you the last scripture here I want to share. Psalm chapter 3, verses 3 through 6. This is out of the NIV, so follow along here. It says, but you, Lord, are a shield around me. This is such a good word to read. My glory and the one who lifts, not only lifts my head high, but lifts my head high. Isn't that good? I call out to the Lord and he answers me from his holy mount. I lie down and sleep and I wake. Why? Because the Lord sustains me. I woke up this morning, he's like, good morning. It's another new day I've made for you. Joy is here in the morning. Isn't it good? Come on. I love this. And I love the last part of this is so good. He says, I will not fear though tens of thousands assail me on every side. Can you feel that? I've never felt the oppression in this nation that I felt in the last few months. If you're with me, spirits of fear, spirits of depression, of discouragement, like it's always going to be this way. Oh, people are dying. And it's like, no, we need to not allow that stuff to be upon us. We need to rehearse that, right? Though tens of thousands assail me on every side, I will not fear. All right? Come on. We believe wholeheartedly that the fervent prayer of a righteous man, a righteous woman avails much. What does that mean? It has a lot of power. And our staff has been praying continuously. We've been praying for God's divine protection over your lives. We've been praying for God's divine provision in your lives. We've also prayed for his presence to fill your hearts and your homes. Amen? So come, we're going to take some time this morning. We're going to pray over four target areas. We're going to first pray for the church in general. We're going to pray for the businesses in our economy. We're going to pray for the government, and we're also going to pray for family. So can we do that? Can you stay with us for a few moments, folks? Come on, just stay engaged. We're going to pray for about 15, 20 minutes here, different areas. So if you're with your family, grab hands and just agree with us in prayer. So Patty Leach is going to jump in here with Josh McCready and to the first part.
How much fun are we having? Because we're reminding ourselves of who we are and the authority that we walk in. So I want to begin by praying for the church, the called out ones, because we are in a moment of history. We're in a moment of history never like before, where we're in a place of influence, the body of Christ around the world and here at Life Center. And as been demonstrated in recent months, whether we're scattered in homes like the early church did, the church is not a building, but we are a body of people. We're believers around the world. And this is who I'm going to be praying for right now. So for the church, first for Life Center, that your strategic purposes, God, would be released in this time, and that we would fulfill the calling that you have placed on this house and on all of our lives. But in this season of seeming darkness, I pray for cascades of awakening, waves of awakening, cascading over the church, and that our hearts would feel them crashing down upon us on every heart, bringing fresh revelations of your purposes, of your faithfulness, that would make us see through eyes of hope. And I pray that every day we would hear, it's a new day, it's a new day, it's a new day, as an alarm to our hearts, and we'd wake up to hope that, as Bryan said, we wouldn't be shrinking back, but we'd be remember who we are and press into that as people of influence. And that no one would hit the snooze button, that no one would put their lives on delay, that no one would say, not today, Lord, but we would rise up and be the people that we are to be, to contribute to what you have for us. And I want to take time and declare Isaiah 60, 1 through 4 over us as Life Center. To arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is upon you. As darkness has blanketed the earth and gloom has in this time covered the nations, that God will arise, will break out upon us, and his brightness of his glory appear over us. I pray that Life Center would be an expression of your heart on the earth, that as a body, we would rise up in your splendor, and that we would be radiant. We'd be captured by the fear of the Lord, and our lives would be evidence of awe and wonder. And we declare also that the prodigals are coming home. David mentioned this earlier. We lift up our eyes. This is at the end of Isaiah 60, verse 4. We'll lift up our eyes, we'll look around, and that we'll believe that our sons are returning from far away and our daughters are being tenderly carried. So if that's you, if you have a loved one that you're believing for, would you stand up right now? And I just declare what it says in Scripture. Watch as they all gather together, eager to return. They're eager to return in this time. And we declare to you, prodigals, your robes, your rings, your sandals, they're waiting for your return. So finally, in these days, just like the first in Pentecost, I want to cry out for the Spirit and the wind, the sound and the wind, to rush your church as you release a fresh wind of your Spirit, that it would be the sound of a mighty wind rushing your church, rushing the earth today, that there would be the sound of new songs released in this body, that such a sound that it would usher in the fire of the Holy Spirit, and we would be a people that are seized with power, that we are seized by the outpouring of the Spirit of God as these lyrics and melodies are released, that we will be here on this hill, that from this place prophetic worship would go out and it would seize people into the reality of how to walk in the power of the living God. I pray that we would be so filled, God, that we would be united in prayer, we'd be gripped with passion, and our lives would be given to making you famous. In Jesus' name.
Well, I had a dream this week that everybody was getting a watch because it was time. And I just say that God has a watch with your name on it because it's time. And that he who formed you in the womb and who made your personality, who made you, made a watch for you. And that maybe for such a time as this, God is preparing something for you. And I say that you weren't born just to have pleasure on earth. You were born to know your maker. You were born to be known so fully by him and fully know him. And you were made to declare him. And I say that we are not going back to where we were. We're going to where we've never been before, where the world has never been before. God is taking us someplace. You know, and I feel that it's a time for courage and hope. And I pray that we would be able to look past what the news is portraying and the way things seem, and that we would look fully into heaven, and that the narrative of God would be revealed to our hearts, that we would understand that Jesus is cooking up something so spectacular. Father, I pray, release courage and release vision, that this is a time for countdown. that it's like it's Christmas and it's getting closer and closer, and the day of visitation is coming, and that God is not coming just to give us a drink. He's coming to possess his body, to fill his body. Then they're going to arise with healing in their wings. And I just say this, that it's not too late. I want to speak to every heart, and I say it is not too late. It's not too late to jump in, that God has a watch waiting for you, that he has a timing for you, that there is a tsunami of the mercy of God that is going to crash upon this nation. And I say this, that it is a time of explosive hope, of radical hope, of miracle upon miracle upon miracle. And we delight that we're in a position where a miracle has to happen, that we get to have a God who lets us walk on water, who delivers us from something that's impossible unless he shows up. And I say, after this shaking is the arising. And it's 2 Corinthians chapter 3. It says, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. And I say, when America turns to the Lord, the masks are going to come off. And that God has great plans, that he's a God of tremendous hope, that he's overflowing with kindness towards this nation and the nations of the earth. So church, I bless you. Rise up. Our God is a God of crazy hope. In Jesus' name, amen.
Whew. Thanks, Josh. Man, I love the church. I love this next section we're praying for. It is the economy and business. I believe it's powerful, it's spiritual, and it transforms our very culture and society. And now to all those business leaders and business owners, those who are working in this area, I want you to stand to your feet. I want you to pray first with me, because I believe you have the power of the prophetic in you. You can see the potential in the land through big goods and services, and you actually reach out and you pull that potential into reality. So let's first do this. We break the power of this COVID disease in the name of Jesus. Stand with me. Stretch your hands out right now. All you business leaders, yeah, business leaders, not healers, yes, you are. You're a healer of the land, and you also see that potential. You're prophetic, so speak to it. Just see the land coming into peace and the stop of this disease, because we know that it comes to threaten, but we know that God is more powerful in Jesus' name. So we stop that spread right now, and so now we turn to the economy, and man, let the roar come out of you. This truth is that God is powerful, and in us, he says in Deuteronomy 8, he's the one that gives us the power to create wealth. How important is that? That through our actions, our faith, our love of serving, building trust, the commerce of individuals and lives, that we have the power to create wealth. Not take from somebody else, but bring into that which is in our hearts the wealth of a land. Create even more wealth by goods and services and creativity and exchange. Every commerce, every exchange of life is trust, and in that is this luminous power to create wealth. And so we pray that right now in Deuteronomy 8. Father, we pray, bring the power to create wealth in among us, God. For business leaders and business owners, for workers and businesses that care for this whole area, God, we pray for every exchange, every strategy, every idea, every connection, heart, and relationship, God, on that you pour out the power to create wealth. God, it's so amazing. God, we pray also, secondly, that with great blessing and wealth, the house is filled with the wise or wisdom. It says that out of Psalm 112. So with the power to create wealth, which brings purpose in our lives to establish God's covenant, then we also believe that with wealth, there's wisdom. That means there's strategies. And we are known, the Americans are known for adaptation, ingenuity, the ability to adjust and make things, tweak things, and find the power and the blessing in things. And so we pray that right now. Come on, business leaders, stand with me. Father, we ask for wisdom. We cry out like Solomon. For all the world, you could have given him everything. He cried out for wisdom. We too, as business leaders and business operators and owners, we ask for your strategies and wisdom, how to change, how to tweak, how to do business in a kingdom way, how to raise up your covenant and establish it in men's lives. By the very ways we conduct our business and lives, God, we pray. Pour out your wisdom among us. Help us to see the silver lining. Help us to find the right vein that brings life to those around us and peace and health and provides for all those. God, there is a way through this forest, And God, we know there's a great meadow of peace and grace, blessing and wealth and riches, not for to waste on ourselves, God, but to establish your covenant in all those that we have contact with, we spread out our heart to. Chronicles 29:17 says this, that his riches and honor come from you. So we remind ourselves, every business leader, every business owner, that it doesn't come from the state or from all the other things that the government, we don't get our wealth from them, but we get it from God, the Father. He gives us wealth. He's the one that it comes from. Father, you, come on, pray with me. You are my source. You are our source. And no matter what we see in our circumstances right now, we know that you're the source of our lives and you bring provision to us. And it will find its way to us as we partner and join with you and believe you. So it doesn't come from this or that. It comes from you. You're the one that gives us the provision. You're the one it all comes from. Then finally, it says in Ezekiel 16:53, and I love this, that you are the one who restores from our captivity. What a great word for today. You restore us from our captivity. And I know God restores. I personally know it in my life. And I've seen him do it here and there all through my life. Where it seems like it's down, he comes back with a vengeance, a great holy vengeance, and restores more than what was there. So agree with me, business leaders and owners, right now, that God, you will restore our captivity. He even says in the scripture that he restores the city of Sodom, the wealth of Sodom. You restore the city of Harrisburg. You restore the wealth and the whole region that's out there. And all the surrounding region, over 500,000 people in the surrounding 25 miles around Harrisburg. God, we pray as you restore this city, you restore the wealth of the land and it comes back. And then it also says in part B, you restore our own personal fortunes. God, we believe that you will do this. You will restore. Come on, stretch your hands out. Father, restore right now. We open every door, window in the spirit. We open every channel of wealth and blessing. Let it come to us, God, and we in wisdom, we in knowing that you are our source, knowing, God, that you gave us the power to create wealth, to establish your covenant. We will do this in Jesus' name. Can you shout amen? Amen. Come on, Jolene.
Amen. All right, I just want to pray over the grace to reset your businesses. We are in a tipping point, and this is a Joshua 5 moment. And I believe we've been standing as business leaders, declaring the word of the Lord. And all of a sudden, someone is standing in front of us. I feel like it's the commander of the army, and we're saying, what do we do now? Whose side are you on, theirs or ours? And I keep hearing this, neither. A sovereign move of God is happening. And then the commander of the army in Joshua 5 says, take off your shoes, you're on holy ground. And I believe that's what's happening in business today. So God, I just pray for grace to understand how to apply the new in business. God, as we are stepping into a new place, there is a sovereign move that you're doing. It is making you famous in the economy of our lives. God, you are becoming famous in business, and I believe you're giving us new shoes to walk in. It is a new day, and we are in holy ground here, and you're showing us how to navigate. So I just pray grace to reset in this tipping point, that we step into what it is you're doing in business, and we follow a line with it. And I want to declare a special blessing over women in business. I want to declare Isaiah 50 verse 4 over every woman in business, that you would have words of wisdom for every weary one in your path. And that you will wake up every morning and you will know the word of the Lord for that day. That there will absolutely be clothing on you that is strength and dignity. And you will laugh in the future and what it holds, because there's no fear inside of you. So I declare that out. Where there's been emotional exhaustion, that there would be grace coming onto you, that there would be strength and dignity. Where there's been so much battle for your affection, Father, I just declare that you would give a special grace over every woman in the business place to be able to nurture and call to life all of those that they work with. God, I just declare that out for this season. No weariness and a reset, complete reset in Jesus' name.
Thank you. Beautiful. Our praises go on and on and on forever. We live in a land of freedom. We're going to be praying for the government. And I just want to acknowledge and give God thanks for His holy experiment that is the United States of America, that is unlike any other nation. And it's just amazing that we steward this. There is this call to pray continually for our government, but also to be involved and also to put action behind our faith. Proverbs 14:34 is a great verse. It says, righteousness exalts a nation. And to the degree that we are a righteous nation, to the degree that we pursue righteousness, there's an exaltation. But it says sin is a shame to any people, or sin is a reproach to any people. It means literally a shame, like something that shouldn't even be mentioned. And so there's no doubt that we are in a great warfare in our own nation at this time. And so we call you to pray for our nation. Every pagan culture is characterized by blood sacrifice and by sexual perversion. If you can go all through the Bible, and you'll see the societies that were judged had those properties. And we need to pray for the end of abortion in America. Far worse than the COVID crisis is the abortion crisis that's been going on day after day, year after year. Let's pray. Let's repent of our sins. Let's humble ourselves. Let's cry out as a priestly company for the sins of our nation. And we repent and we say, God, help us heal our land. Bring us back to righteousness. We need to pray for the sanctity of life and the sanctity of the family. The family, as God designed it, is part, it's the basic institution of any blessed culture. And can we pray right now? We just want to pray, and we say, Father, in Jesus' name, wherever you are in your homes, grab hands, close your eyes. God, forgive us. Forgive us as a nation. Forgive us our sins of selfishness and sensuality, our sins of disregarding the most helpless human beings on the planet, those in the womb who have no voice. God, forgive us. Purify us. We humble ourselves, God. We pray for the end of abortion in America. We pray that you will send your spirit and you'll heal the land. We pray you'll stir up your people, that we will be a prophetic people. We won't be under the state. We won't be over the state, but we'll be the conscience of the state. We'll be a prophetic voice to the state. And here's how you can do it. You can register to vote. You can pray, but put feet to your prayers. Register to vote. Tomorrow, if you live in Pennsylvania, is the deadline to register to vote for the primary in June, and then just pray that God will raise up righteous candidates. Raise up righteous candidates. Every election in the last, 10, 20 years has been decided by a very small margin. If the body of Christ would register, if the body of Christ would pray and vote for life, we could totally change the culture of this nation. Let's pray for that. Father, I pray for a prophetic activation for the body of Christ to pray, to hear what's right, to not be swayed by the news, not be swayed by political, what's in, what's out, but to hear from heaven and to live for righteousness. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
So good. Yeah, let's keep this theme of government. Just want to pray into it. I know, whenever a political spirit is involved, things get confusing and it's hard to see clearly, and deception is at work. And so right now, we just want to pray against deception and confusion in governmental sectors. God, we just pray for clarity upon our governmental leaders right now. God, I pray for the staffers who support the governmental leaders, God, that you would infiltrate that area, God, that you would influence that area, God, and that there would be such clarity, God, that the laws that are being pushed and the laws that are being written, God, have Christian hands and Christian principles on them, God. Father, that your Holy Spirit would continue to work throughout every
different governmental department, God. God, I pray that leaders would be courageous in representing the gospel, God, that there would be something that stirs up inside them, Lord. Father, I pray that the church would be activated, God, into the political realm, God, that we would start influencing this nation on a cultural and political level, God. Father, I pray that relationships that leaders have with others, God, would be of a Christian nature, God. Father, I pray that you would influence Congress, the judges, God. Father, every single aspect, Lord, that the grace and the peace of the Lord would be upon them, that there would be this mantle on them, Lord. And we say yes and amen to everything you're doing from top down. God, we just thank you that you're in it, that you are involved in it, that you're going to bring up new leaders. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah, I'm going to take our last prayer focus for today. We're going to pray for the families. And God just led me to the Psalm 112. I just want to read this for you. It says, "Praise the Lord. Blessed are those who fear the Lord, who find great delight in his commands. Their children will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. Even in darkness, light dawns upon the righteous. For those who are gracious and compassionate and righteous, God will come to those who are generous and lend freely, who conduct their affairs with justice. Surely the righteous will never be shaken. They will be remembered forever. They will have no fear of bad news. Their hearts are steadfast, trusting in the Lord." So as we pray for families today, I just want to declare that your family has an opportunity, is an opportunity for your society, for your community, for where you're at. And each person in your family is part of this promise, is part of this thing to stand before the Lord in great trust, in destiny for what he wants to do in this. And I believe that every family is included in this. And if you're saying to me like, "I don't know, we have a dysfunctional family, we're all of this," God loves to use dysfunctional families and redeem things that have been broken and twisted and distorted for generations. Look, just read the Old Testament. It's normal for God to take families that are not as you'd expect and turn them for his glory. So for those of you that are saying that, I just declare today, I believe there's a grace for generational brokenness to be ended, for generational like patterns and behaviors to be done in Jesus' name, that there would be a righteousness that would come from this generation forward in every family line, that there'd be a right standing, that there'd be just this generosity that would pour out of families, a generosity of love, a generosity of giving, a generosity of just believing in great faith for what God is yet to do. So as we come out of this, that family would once again be placed in where it belongs in our society and culture. So Jesus, we just declare over every family, God, life, peace, prosperity, God, would just flow to our families, to our communities. God, we bless these families in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks, Ben. Come on, one more time. We're just going to pray for families. God, we hold up those that have infant children, small children. God, we say grace, grace, grace to them right now. Come on, we pray for little infants, God, toddlers to have experiences like David's Harper would, God, that they would encounter you in communion, and they encounter you in their dreams. And Father, we thank you for those that are even graduating. I thought about this the last few weeks. As you've graduated high school, or you just graduated college, or you just finished a trade school, and you think, "Oh, no one's hiring." I'm telling you, God's plans have not changed for you. His plans are right on target. He knew exactly what's going to happen. Enjoy these days. Dig in deeper with the Lord. So, Father, we pray your grace over families. We pray the peace of you, God, would overwhelm families. God, we pray the presence of you, God, would come and settle in living rooms and kitchens, Father God, and in dining rooms, Father. We pray, come and fill homes with your holy presence. God, for all those that are single and say, "I don't have a family," I'm telling you, God knows your life right now. God, you would just overwhelm them, and they would feel included. They feel involved. They feel accepted and loved all the time, God. They know your loving arms are around them. They're a part of this family of Life Center. We pray in Jesus' name, bless, bless, bless. Come on, let's take a moment. We're going to sing for a few moments. We're going to close. We believe it. Our praise will go on and on and on because your goodness goes on and on and on forever, God. God, thank you for this time. Thank you for this morning. Come on, we just pray everyone is watching, listening, even if you listen to this later, God, you'll be blessed blessed of the Lord. We speak blessing, blessing, blessing of God upon you. We look forward. We can't wait to gather back here again. Look forward to some news this week. We're looking to gather again, and we're really excited. So be blessed. So glad you could be with us. Have a wonderful week. In Jesus' name, amen.